Welcome to Wise Beyond Bitcoin, your home for the crypto neo news, education, and opportunities, and the macro updates. My name is Ryan.
My name is Lucas, and we've got some macro updates, macro news. It's more in the realm of regulation and the future of the development of blockchain and crypto alongside traditional markets, which we've covered a lot and will continue to cover a lot. So if you like this information, staying up to date on the latest and greatest macro news and crypto news, subscribe, notification bell. We appreciate all that. None of this is financial advice, commercial advice, legal advice, or marital advice. It's just educational, entertainment information. But I suppose let's just get started. The direction we want to go is, and where what we've covered before is, where does blockchain and crypto stand as a new technology to be able to grow and develop and to emerge as more people are learning about it alongside pre-existing regulations and laws and statutes to protect people from, you know, unscrupulous or, you know.
Well, one of our main points is that, you know, rather than trying to reinvent the wheel and try to pass a whole new suite of laws and regulations to cover blockchain, that it does seem rather obvious that the existing laws seem more than adequate to handle any of the egregious cases of Ponzi scheme, you know, fraud, those sorts of problems. Like, it's not that we need to reinvent any new legislation, because the laws that exist, you know, are already adequate to deal with this, right?
Absolutely. And we'll go into that. So with this article, the SEC is going after, a specific crypto pyramid Ponzi scheme, which is...
Four stage.
It's funny when you hear about things like this, because here's where I would like to go with this. When people see this as sensational news, it's very sensational. $300 million fraud Ponzi scheme. And when people read that in the paper, like, oh my gosh, this is horrible. I'm glad the SEC is doing something about that. What's so funny is that Forsage is... I've been in crypto. Have you ever heard of Forsage?
I've never heard of this. Yeah.
Almost nobody has ever heard of Forsage. It's not like it's some big deal. It's been around. I don't even know what it is. And yet you look in traditional markets, in the SEC, we did a video on Pandora Papers, on the Panama Papers. And this is the what I would like to continue to reiterate and bring back. Get rid of the scams and all that stuff, and crypto's fine. But at the end of the day, most of the population, most Americans, you talk about the SEC in the United States, most of the people that need protection, those are people that it's their 401ks, their pension funds, their bank accounts from the Fed and the interest rates and inflation and what's going on in the markets there, or the over-leveraged, what's going on with traditional markets, that the prices drop down and people lose their assets and they're not able to retire. There are a lot of things happening in the traditional markets that need oversight, that need to protect people. And the reality is most people don't know what blockchain and crypto is, other than a sensationalized news article. Most people that read that article, see that news article, don't know anything about blockchain or crypto. They're just reading that and saying, well, I'm glad the SEC's here. Meanwhile, the SEC is not doing anything about all the fraud and all the scams that are going in the traditional financial system, which pales in comparison. What's so funny is that how does Gary Gensler, Janet Yellen, how do these people, these senators, have time to sit there and pretend like, I'm very concerned about crypto and people getting scammed? It's like, there's barely any activity even going on here compared to all of the activity, all of the money and all the scams that are going on. Why don't you focus on fixing the traditional market that you made the rules for? You literally made the rules for traditional markets and SEC, and you still have all this corruption and all this going on. SEC come out with news articles. How come we don't see them coming out with saying another politician or another, crony, what was it? Those shell companies for taxes. You know, how come we don't hear every day about these people being brought to justice, where we know the Pandora Papers and Panama Papers out, and all of a sudden we're hearing these no-name groups about crypto and blockchain, like Janet Yellen, Gary Gensler? They've got nothing better to do than to find a blockchain platform that has 11 people.
And I would, you know, to put another angle on it is, how is it that we're focusing on ForeSage, which, like you say, we've never ever heard of, when things like Amway are continued year after year to do the very same thing, but at a much larger scale, right? You know, $300 million, that's, you know, I don't have the numbers ahead in front of me, but I'm positive that Amway does many, many, many times that number every year. Yet it's, you know, it's a Ponzi scheme that is not, you know, no one's saying anything about. But the second you put it into a smart contract and put it on the blockchain, now all of a sudden it's, you know, we've got to do something about this. And, you know, fine, do something about it, you know. But let's keep it, but the point here we're making is let's keep it in perspective that there's a lot of, in the mainstream traditional markets.
Well, you should be upset if your retirement, you know, and you've been working hard your whole life, and the SEC and these agencies, they're out there to protect you. You should be kind of upset that they're spending so much time and resources on this new burgeoning industry that has ill effect on you right now, when in the meantime your finances are more at risk from all the problems that are going on in the traditional market. It should be like, why are you even talking about this right now when you still haven't even fixed the real problem going on? And that goes back to another thing is, a couple of years ago, all of these people were saying this technology is basically pointless and it's a scam. Literally just a few years ago, Bitcoin and crypto was all a scam. Now the same people that were telling you not to look at it are out there protecting you and know what's in your best interest to
well, now they're saying we need to make sure it's under the auspices of the Securities Exchange Commission or the Commodities Futures Trading Commission, right? So we're clearly seeing that these things are not scams if we're looking to find ways to integrate them into the traditional financial markets, right? So it's like, pick one, because it can't be both, right?
Now, that being said, we talked about this before the video. That doesn't mean there's no place for oversight and regulation. Like you mentioned at the beginning of the video, there are already laws in place to protect people from scams and from Ponzi schemes and MLMs. And those can be enforced on centralized, on more traditional.
On smart contracts, even.
Even so, but you know, you look at Coinbase and Binance, and there are many brokerages that basically have banking licenses to bring retail investors into blockchain and crypto. And if there's to be oversight and there's to be protection and monitoring, it would be done, I would say, in a healthy way on those intermediaries, that those banking crypto intermediaries. That's where it most logic.
Well, and we could be more specific. Those kinds of entities that take custody of your assets, right? Or that require some kind of identification, KYC, AML, right? Or if they have direct lines of credit to, you know, Wall Street venture capitalists, you know, that's another thing. Or if there's a team with a foundation that's managing, and there's, you know, team tokens, and there's some sort of or if there's any kind of guaranteed profit sharing or rewards, you know, there's lots of little details that can add up to whether or not this is a project fits in one bucket or the other. But largely, all of those things go together. And I think you're right that, you know, for the projects and the companies that do business in that way, by all means, let the rules apply to them. They already should. And I would add to that list the centralized stable coins. The ones that are pegged to a dollar, that say we have so many millions or billions of dollar assets that we have on the books of some financial entity, you know, that sounds like a something that should fall under securities or commodities regulation. Why not, right? But for those stable coins that are decentralized, they're say like Frax or Mem or even Shade that are operating in a different manner, You know, I don't, I think that should be, you know, there should be space for that, right? We should not close the door on innovation just because, you know, some definition isn't met or some new way of doing things doesn't fit into the framework that we've passed, right?
That brings a last point, a good segue about, it's about education. It's disingenuous for a group of people, you know, who are in power of the traditional, you know, financial markets, who haven't had the time, much less to get control of that market and weed out all of the corruption, all the problems going on. But to pretend that all of a sudden they just know how crypto works and the direction it's going, it's a new technology that you've got people in a decentralized manner building and experimenting all the time. That would be like when airplanes first came out, if the horse and buggy industry or car industry, automotive said, well, we're just going to be in charge of this because we're in charge of transportation. It's like, but you don't
know. We know it's best, right?
Yeah, it's like, but you don't know anything about aerodynamics and flight. It's like, it doesn't matter. We're in charge of transportation, and that's what we do, and you come through us. It's like, yeah, right. But cars are different than airplanes. And we're in a similar situation here where blockchain and crypto, it operates differently. There's a difference between proof of work and proof of stake. And there's a difference between staking on a smart contract and proof of stake for network security on a layer one. And are these nuances understood by the lawmakers? Are these nuances understood by the people that they would like to enforce these laws on? I think that we're in such an early stage. It makes more sense for there to be more focus on education and experimentation. Mentioned before, it'd be great if oversight and could be focused on those areas that you have intermediaries, that the laws already know where they fit and where they apply. But we should also have a time for humanity, for blockchain, which is a technology that belongs to the world. It's not relegated to any nation state or boundary. There should be an opportunity to allow this technology to develop and to see, hey, we need flaps on these wings, or hey, we need a tail will really help this.
Or hey, algorithmically pegged stablecoins might not be the way to go, right? But how would you know if you didn't let that?
Or they need to operate in this way. They don't work unless you do this. So absolutely. Right. But you know, if the goal is to reach, like Bitcoin, what blockchain can do, if the goal is to bring us tools, whether it's sending information or whether it's sending money, value transactions, the goal is to get us to a place where we can do these things in a safe and secure way without the need of intermediaries. That's the whole goal, is to allow smart contracts, allow code as law, allow this technology to do what it's supposed to do.
And you know, I'd word that another way. We've seen that regulation and legislation is not a keyhole solution to financial stability. Just look at the boom bust in the traditional markets, look at the fraud, look at Pandora, Panama Papers. So clearly, we're not going to solve these big problems by just passing the right laws. And you know, to some degree, Bitcoin and blockchain exist because of how inefficient that system is, and or was, and still is. So let's let technology and innovation, and you know, taking the lumps, right, of that come with making bad investments or seeing a tokenomics not work out. Let's let that system play out for a little while before we say, oh, we're going to only solve these problems through regulation, because it's done a lot so far, right? We've already innovated so far on this path. It's created things no one could have envisioned prior to, and it's solving problems like front running that even traditional markets are still wrestling with, right? So, and we're seeing secret network, we're seeing privacy by default, smart contracts solve that problem, and in a way that you could never legislate or regulate away. So I think that's the model for how we solve these problems, is through letting entrepreneurship and innovation try to do what regulation hasn't done. And if we pass, you know, bills that shut that down, we're going to end up missing out on solutions that the regulators never would have thought of. And, you know, and what they will think of probably won't be the 100% solution to our problems. It hasn't been thus far. So some food for thought on that.
And let's focus on, I would say, if you are in a regulatory oversight position, focused on the biggest fish, you know, focused on those that are causing the most damage and wreaking the most havoc on others in the financial markets. I had never in my life heard of Forsage. I don't know. I tend to believe that the member results and all participants, that it's so easy to create wallet addresses and fabricate and make communities.
Right. Bots.
With bots and other things. Like, this whole thing almost seems contrived, as if I never even heard of this until the SEC came after it, just to show.
That's kind of how BitConnect was. I had barely heard of BitConnect, and then I heard about them getting shut down. It's like, where did this come from? Who are the people that are buying into this?
It was commercials, and BitConnect had become kind of popular for a while. But I mean, Forsage, I did not even know that this, and there could be many scams like this, for sure, like BitConnect and like this. And it's good to do your own research. That's why we do this channel. We provide education, because decentralized finance, your wallet, your keys, whether or not you provide liquidity to help AMMs, to help certain communities grow or not, or you just stake, or you're mining, or you're just hodling, there are different levels of risk. Not all of them are the same as whatever that website was foresaw. Just not like crypto itself is this black box where you run the risk of. No, there's different levels of risk, and it depends upon, you know, how much risk you wish to take and which communities you wish to be a part of. These are new emerging technologies. Like you mentioned, privacy on blockchain, NFTs, data storage. There are a lot of beautiful, fun, exciting things happening, and it's revolutionizing the future of markets, the economy, the way we exchange information. And part of what makes this new technology, you know, you mentioned Bitcoin being born from some of the errors in traditional markets. One of the biggest draws is how, through code as law, smart contracts, you remove the risk of intermediaries. And that's what we should love to see flourish and see experimentation, and allow blockchain to continue to develop and create solutions. Because if regulators come in and say, you have to go through us, and we'll put a stamp of approval before you're allowed to build on a blockchain, it's like we are preventing, it's like having cars being pulled by horse and buggies. It's like the plane industry being regulated by the automotive industry. And it's a lot of things that don't make sense, in except for the people that
serves a narrow interest, but it not for the common good, right? At the expense of the common good.
Absolutely.
We'll continue talking about this stuff. I mean, we have a whole playlist on Secret Network, and especially the NFTs that are involved there, because that's a theme we return to a lot. We're gonna have blockchain
is a thing, and there are other developments, other exciting developments. Interoperability is another thing.
Yep.
And there are things going on outside of the IBC and Secret Network, which we'll continue to cover. Macro outlooks, macro updates as well. So you know what to do if you like to stay abreast of the latest and greatest. Subscribe, notification bell. And if you want to keep these desk lamps lit and this production quality on fire, then you know what to do. Drop a little donation below to that whale address, and feed the whales. Or no, wait, we're not the whales feed us. I don't know. You know how it works.
We're the guppies. The plankton.
Until the next time, have a beautiful day. Namaste.
Thank you.